He couldn't have stopped.
If he was a butt face, I could have made it.
What are you supposed to be, a clown or something?
Sometimes.
It's more like surfing than skating. I wish the rain would stop just once.
It can't rain all the time.
Eric?
Hi everyone, and welcome to another episode of Trip Around the Multiverse with your host, the guy who seems to have terrible luck with dying in front of members of his family, Carl Charles, and...
And the white boy who may or may not be Mexican, but has a Mexican name, so Hollywood.
And for some reason... CY like talked me into watching The Crow sequels.
First of all, right? We were going through comic book films as well, so it's not as if it's randomly out of blue.
No, it's not.
But yes, we are going to not exactly great territory here.
No.
Now, obviously, the first one is really good. Even if you say story wise or style or character, like. The presentation of it, right?
Yeah.
There's something about it where you're like, yes, it's got that vibe, right?
Yeah.
And the villains were, I don't want to say too hammy or anything like that, but they had character.
Yeah.
And they're only over the top out of frustration. Sometimes, you know, when you just get, you get so worked up, you're like, oh, and you say something really, you know.
Yeah.
But in the rest of these films, which is The Crow, Sea of Angels from 1996, The Crow Salvation, 2000, right? And it's Crow Wicked Prayer in 2005. You're like, yeah, these villains, what? I have to say, The Crazy of Angels is like The Crow, but on crack, it seems.
I'll say, yeah, probably the closest one to the first one.
The villains are on crack because as notable as the villains there in the first one were, they were there to be villains, right? They knew their role.
Yeah.
These villains, though, were there to do what exactly?
Nothing.
To steal screen time away from the guy playing the Crow? That's just, it seems like... Oh, by the way, do you see your boy Thomas Jane?
I thought that was him. he went up in the world. Wow, good on him.
Well, first of all, I'd say 100% he was committed. I'll give you that, yeah? Hilarious sequence where, you just can't keep your face... I don't know how they filmed it and they thought, okay, this is something.
People are going to love this. Yeah.
No, not even loved it. Okay, so essentially The Crow is a supernatural horror film revenge thriller, yeah?
It's meant to be. It's meant to be.
Oh, the first one, right?
Yeah.
So Thomas Jane is walking into the naked lady, the booth where the naked, the clothed lady, where you put the coins in. And then she starts... I don't even think she was taking her clothes off or anything like that.
I don't even know.
ASMR?
Yeah. Because you're just talking to him. Yeah.
And then I don't know how much he put in, like 50 cents or whatever?
Something stupid.
And he only had like a minute. And he was definitely doing something. He was doing vigorous actions, right? While on the phone to the girl. And then his money ran out. So... He starts scrambling for more money and everything like that. And then he puts the money in, lights, because the lights went out. The lights kind of start coming on and he starts continuing his sequence of events, right?
Yeah.
And then the guy, the crow there, Ash Corbin's there instead of the girl. And I was like, what? Where? And Thomas Jane, I don't know if he stopped or carried on because he's like, at this point, you know, all right. Yeah. And I'm like, all right, I don't know if the Crow's meant to be... I mean, Eric Draven did say stuff, but... And it was more, I would say, sarcastic kind of smart Alex stuff. But maybe. These people... Well, yeah, but they definitely weren't trying to be one-liner jokers.
No.
Yeah. Okay, right. Of these sequels, which did you like the most? Oh, and then which one, obviously, did you dislike the most?
I will probably say, strangely, the third one.
Oh, you like that the most?
Well, they're all terrible, but...
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was the only one that I kind of didn't mind, because the story was okay. Like, yeah. It had a kind of a reason behind it. The other ones just, I don't understand what happened at all.
Oh, okay, and which one didn't you like
the
most?
Didn't like the most was the last one, Wicked Prayer. That was terrible.
Hello, hello?
Hello? You there?
Hello?
Yeah, you there? Hello? Oh.
Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Hello? Yeah?
You hear me?
Yeah, yeah, I heard you now. Where, I don't know. I was asking which one you didn't like. You were saying which one you liked the most, and then I said, oh, okay. Which one didn't you like the most? But I don't know if you were talking in between that or...
Oh, no, because I'm looking at the voice... Well, in a little window...
Yeah.
The quality's dropping, like, now.
Okay.
Right. But, oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I see. It's gone red, yeah.
Yeah. Don't know what that means.
Yeah, yeah.
But,
My end or your end? Don't know. Fine now.
He's fine now. We'll just carry on.
Yeah. Okay.
What I didn't like the most... The last one was terrible. Like they're all equal. They're all bad, but the last one was probably the worst one of the lot.
All right, right. So I enjoyed the second one more than the rest. Not saying it's great or anything like that, but it's just like it's a copy and paste of the first one. But at least it's meant to be what it is. It is right. Yeah. I know you're right with the third one. By the way, it changes up the idea of it. Right. Okay, so as far as the third one goes, so he's not just he got framed for his girlfriend's death, and he got put in the electric chair, and then the electric. Oh, by the way, you know when he got took the electric chair mask off?
Yeah.
The Dead Space mask.
Yeah.
And then it's like the melt his flesh on his face. I was like, oof.
Yeah.
And then he basically kind of like pulled it off, but you know, just kind of. He did actually pull it off, but it wasn't, you know, like he was just ripping it off or anything like that. And then you got the burn marks for the crow makeup. I'm like, okay. I thought it actually started off pretty decently.
Yeah.
Then it kind of turned into a police procedural kind of?
Kind of.
Yeah. The corrupt cops killed his girlfriend because they... Because she was the daughter of a corrupt cop. And she saw them, you know, being corrupt. Like, right, why don't you just, you know, you're going to kill your friend's daughter, your cohort's daughter, right? And expect him to be happy about it. Right, you know?
yes.
Yeah. I didn't. And then the man with the scar on his arm, like it's fugitive, you know?
Yeah. Like, I'll probably, again,
I tell you, it's also is funny because he died. He when he escaped the prison.
Yeah.
After he's supposed to be dead. After he died and came back, and then he jumped off the rooftop. Did he turn into a crow and fly away?
I believe. Is that when he's chasing? Wait, is that which one is that one? There's one where someone in a motorbike is getting chased by a crow.
Yeah.
Is that one right? These films are blend to one to me because just.
I don't think that's the one, but that is the one where he jumped on the same movie where he jumped off the T-pose, right? And somehow, because his arms were up like the cross, right? And he kind of semi-floated, semi-kind of diagonally went straight down. I'm like, what? But also, like in the second one as well, where he rises from the water, like blatantly on a platform, right?
Yeah.
But it looked a bit silly. Rising, like you know, they have the platform on the water and rising them up. I will say as well, compared to all of these, right? The first one and the fourth one do have people that are not immediate into the story involved. Like, you know, the first one had the rest of the cops and all the other people, right? Little kids, whatever, scattered civilians or whatever you're making, right? And the fourth one also had the people that weren't necessarily directly involved in the story still within the movie, right?
Yeah.
I will say that the second and third one, it just seemed isolated in that particular area for those particular people who are in the story, kind of, you know.
Yeah.
And I think the second one assumes that you have seen the first one.
Yeah.
In order to get the connections.
Yeah, it did, didn't it?
Yeah, I will say as well, it would have made more sense. The main villain of the second one, if it, you know, the blind lady that cut her eyes out because she could see ghosts or whatever, right?
Yeah.
If she was the Asian lady from the first one who got her eyes picked out,
yeah.
Logically speaking, then that can go from there to there.
Yeah.
And I think maybe they were wanting to do that, but you know, then they just they maybe, you know, casting, or maybe they couldn't get her, whatever. They just decided, you know, we'll just because the way it's built up is she's in this, she's given all these riddles, she, like, as she's done this before, not supernatural spells or whatever, but just like cloaks cover her face. Oh, it's going to be a massive reveal, right?
No, yeah, but no.
Just some random person who, yeah, whatever. Okay.
Yeah,
did you notice our girl Lana Lang? Well, I say our girl, but the girl from the Lana Lang from Superman and Lois.
Wait, she was in this.
She was in the, she's the main girl in the Wicked Prayer, in the fourth one.
Oh yeah, for some reason, yeah. No, I thought you meant Lois Lane's. Like, wait, what? No. Lana Lang. Yeah, I noticed. I was like, oh wow.
She looked really young then.
Really young.
Yeah, but the thing is, she was. I was like, hold on, how old is she? She's like 30 there.
Is she?
Yeah.
Oh, but, so how old is she? She's about 50 now.
Well, 40. Because that's like 25
years. Like, that's like 15 years ago. But
yeah, but she looked like she was 24 or something.
Yeah, she looked well young. Okay, good.
Yeah. So. I mean, look, I will say the third one tries to be different, right?
Yeah.
But it just ends up being more of the same.
The third one, to me, sorry to cut you off, it feels like a TV pilot.
Yes, that's what I was also going to say. It tries to be something different with the idea of it, right?
Yeah.
And it does be like, all right, it's not just random thugs that blah, 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 with no dimension of them, but now it's corrupt cops with no dimension either.
Yeah. We're just corrupt because, ha ha ha, sort of thing.
Like, exactly.
Okay.
There's interesting ideas you can put in something like this, with, right? Where it's like, okay, so what if the person who killed, right? Who was killed was, like, if they were an evil couple, will they still come back? Will one of the people come back because they you know, their love is whatever, right? So then, you know, is he killing the good guys? How does that work? Or if you put in different scenarios in there where people think they're doing the right things, like the Wicks trials, and you burn someone.
Yeah.
And I mean, like, then you tweak it from the first one, but add something like a new look to it. It's like, how are we going to deal with this? Rather than, okay. I do have to say, the first one being straightforward is probably what also helps it.
Yeah.
But yeah, they all, okay, everyone's woman seems to get accosted and assaulted.
Yeah.
And it's just like, maybe you could have done with a woman coming back to change it up, you know? But yeah, I'll put the fourth one. The first one had the crime bosses. You know, look, I want to say low-key level threats. There weren't really much to him, but you're just here to... And the mystic, right? And Tony Todd, right? Who always comes off as some sort of, you know, has a presence. Yeah.
Yeah.
But the threat level was decently low because you wanted your villains to get their comeuppance, yeah? And then, obviously, when he got the crow got hurt, he got hurt, right? Fair enough. The second one, with the guy trying to take the crow powers, I thought, okay, a neat idea, right? To put something fresh into it. But I was like, I think there could have been a better execution of it, not necessarily or build to or something like that. It's just been like, okay, he's now got the powers. Oh my goodness, when he strung up Ash, right?
Yeah,
and then he got that whip, like the Mexican Day of the Dead festival, yeah?
Yeah.
Some dude just whipping some other dude, right? Hanging him and whipping him. And the crowd are like, oh yeah, it's all part of a play or something. I don't know what they were reacting, yeah?
Yeah.
They just didn't Unless they obviously knew who he was, right? Because he's a crime boss of that area. Yeah? And he's just like, well, I ain't going to do nothing while he goes and whips this man to death. It's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, but I don't... still... I mean, yeah.
And then where he... when Ash shoves the guy into the pole and he's like, oh, no. I also have the crow power. Now you cannot hurt me. Right? And then Ash gets all them ravens and crows that are flying above to go through him. Like jagged whatever into that the crime boss and kind of black portal him to death or shred him to death. I don't know exactly so these people in the Day of the Dead festival are like, right, what's happening here? We just saw something supernatural. We're just gonna pretend it's all part of a play or what? I don't, none of their reaction, they just tell nothing.
It made no sense.
Yeah
None of the films made sense, if I'm honest.
Yeah. Also, I was like, I think the Sarah character from the first one into the second one, right? So, was she and Ash meant to not necessarily have a relationship, but there were some bits where you're like, are they supposed to be a romance between these two? Because there's some lines they say as though it's alluding towards that, but there's no build to it. It's just like dropped here and there, but random. I guess it's one of those where you need her and him to have some sort of relationship in order for her to risk her life to save him at the end. But there's no build towards it. It's just lines. He says the line to her earlier on, and then she's saying, oh, you know, you do this to go back. And then he's like looking at her longingly. Oh, what if I don't want to go back? And then there's no, all right, but you only just met her.
Yeah. Doesn't make sense.
Though, as a film, individually by itself, I think it's, I don't want to say necessarily it's an entertaining film, but if you watch it and you're like, oh, all right, it ain't terrible. It's quite watchable actually. If you don't pretend you haven't watched the first one and you're just watching something that's, you're like, all right, I'm gonna put it on the side and do stuff.
But is it?
Well, it's not terrible.
It's not great because like.
Yeah. That too. I'd say, would you say because of the way that it I mean, there's some notable elements to it, but I would say it's average. It is what it is and nothing more. Like as an action film.
Probably out of all of them, I would kind of say that. Right. But then, like, when he talks,
yeah,
it's like, I don't know if it's just me. Was he just always talking in riddles? Because it sounded like he's talking.
I was going to say, was it the accent? Because Vincent Perez is a non-native. He's like a Swiss or something like that. Or anything like that. But you just mean, yeah. He says stuff and you're like,
huh?
Yeah.
That's literally, I was like, wait, what?
Yeah, okay. I mean, you're kind of trying to be a bit more of a ham or a bit more over the top of the character. Or are you trying to deliberately be the reverse of the Draven character? Or, you know, wait, what goes here?
I just couldn't get on board about what's going on.
Yeah. Like, yeah. And then when he was terrorizing the first guy, the spider monkey guy who was on crack. And he's like hitting the oil drums and stuff like that. And it's like, I don't. What are you doing?
Yeah, literally. You know? Like, what is
you're this? Meant to come in there, beat these people. I'm not. Okay, so I'm supposed to be getting Batman, the Batman, even, right?
Yeah.
Or Daredevil level vibes, or, you know, Punisher, whatever, right?
Just
kind of. I don't want to say the tone needs to be a certain level, right? It doesn't necessarily need to be dark film, but even though he does most of his action at night, it seems, right? Or daytime if you're on the fourth one, right?
Yeah.
But there needs to be a level of tone here, and the Ash character didn't jive with how you perceive.
No.
A person who comes back from the dead. I mean, when he's normal, right? When he's not terrorizing bad guys, fair enough. But aren't you supposed to be even more creature of the night when you're terrorizing bad guys?
Yeah, but he's not, which is kind of weird.
Yeah.
And like, another problem I sort of have with all these films, they just retreaded the same things.
They become generic, right?
Yeah, literally like...
But here's the thing. Okay. Here's the thing. Let's just say you watched all of these films and then watched the first one last, yeah?
Yeah.
I think the first one would still be the best, even if you're like, all right.
Yeah, yeah, I this, totally agree, yeah.
You know, they follow a generic same sequence, yeah, of the story they're being told.
Yeah.
But there's something about the first one that's just so much more oomph to it.
Because the first one feels unique, that's the thing. Yeah. These ones literally just like, hey, we got the rights to The Crow, we should make a film. And terrible stuff, I mean,
you made a film, whether it's good or not.
art's subjective, but... Mm. Yeah, I don't know. And, like, none of the other... Like... Because I'm not really going to talk much about the first one, because everyone knows how good the first one is and what. But all the other main characters in the film just seem kind of crap.
It's not like, for example, you say they need to have the charisma level of Brad and Lee or something like that. They just don't seem like... Okay. Edward, like, they just don't appealing as much as a protagonist character.
Yeah.
What did you think of the fourth one? Let's start. I'm going to say let's start slating the fourth one, but that seems to be all we're doing. So let's go to the fourth one. Would you actually say that the fourth one might have been better if Boreanaz was the Crow instead of Edward Furlong?
I don't know.
Not saying what the roles around, but
He might have been a better Crow, but still been a terrible film.
Yeah, because the film was just not good in itself, right?
No. And then as soon as you have T.O.T.'s in there, it just adds to it as well.
And Chosen from Street Fighter. Street Fighter. From Cry Kid.
Yeah. And also, what's his name? From The Matrix. I forgot his name.
Yeah. Marcus Chung, yeah. But I can't remember his character name. Tank, was it? No, Tank's his brother.
Switch?
I don't know. Switch is the blonde girl, I'm sure.
Oh, well, whoever he was.
Yeah.
film was weird.
I don't get the story of the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse. I don't know why it needed to be the Four Horsemen.
No.
I don't, yeah. I think it's like David Boreanaz was just like, F this movie, I'm just going to overdo everything, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think at the same time, it's like he was trying to entertain it himself and make the movie entertaining. But he just conflicted with the tone of it so much, you know. But he probably knew, it's not a gonna be a good movie. So let's just make an entertaining movie. But no one else was on his level of train of thought.
No. Also,
they were trying to take it seriously.
Like, I don't really understand their motivations.
Oh yeah, you know what their motivation is? Oh. Because they're evil. But then, that's it.
But then, like, sometimes they were kind of like second guessing what the main dude was saying.
Yeah. Luke Crash, right?
Yeah.
Luke Crash, aka Death, aka the Boreanaz. I don't. I think so. Tara Reid wants to do a ritual, right?
Yeah.
To bring Satan to the world. I don't know exactly, right?
Yeah.
And get Luke possessed by Luke Crash. Lucifer possess Luke Crash's body. And then the Crow, look, there would be a neat story being told if, like, oh, it's the Crow is fighting some sort of demon, whatever, right? But it didn't seem like that was what was going on. They're like, yeah, okay, we get possessed, and then, you know, it's just like, no, you don't have any budget to do anything, it seems.
No.
No supernatural powers, not that it's needed or anything like that, but just like, you're filming in daytime as well, and it looks really bad.
Yeah.
Like, you don't have Batman running around in daytime.
Nope.
No. Or even Daredevil. Well, no. Daredevil's yellow suit. Yeah, okay. Fair enough.
But even then, that's a bit weird. But, like, also, like, the whole, the bad guy's angry because an Indian, as their words, not mine, killed his family, something like that, isn't it?
Okay, no doubt. Here's the thing, right? You see how bad he is, right?
Yeah.
I think the logic is, I mean, I don't know. I don't get his logic. I don't know villain logic, right? But it's just like, maybe, so he'd come out of jail. So clearly something was done that wasn't great, yeah?
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm going to go and kill them because they they did whatever to my family, right? It's yeah. Like, so you're just proving them exactly right why they threw you in jail.
Yeah.
Okay.
And no one in this film was Native American.
Danny Trejo was in this film.
But he's Mexican.
Oh, Emmanuel Chikri.
She's Canadian.
No. Okay. Oh, she... Her nationality is Canadian. Her ethnicity.
I'm pretty sure she's Hispanic of some kind. Let me find out.
All right.
But like, yeah, it's just, I'm just sitting there like, and then Dennis Hopper as well. That's another weird, confusing thing.
Yeah. What was he about, right? He was like, okay, so originally Tara Reid was my home, right?
Yeah.
Somehow, with a 50 years age difference, whatever, right?
Yeah.
She was mine, right? And now you have my off-cast loot crash because you're dead. For what reason? Was there any beef or whatever? The only reason we know that she was with Dennis Hopper in the first place because she stole Dennis Hopper's book of spells or
something
it is.
Something like that.
Yeah. I'm like, huh? Oh, right. I mean, none of it makes sense. Yeah, exactly. Now this.
Also, what's her name? What's her name again? Lana Lang character.
Oh yeah, Emmanuel Chikri. Yeah.
She's Moroccan Jewish.
Oh okay.
Yeah.
Well,
so.
Right. Her surname would have fooled me. But yes. Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
So it's Well, remember, Edward Furlong's meant to be Mexican, so hey, you know, whatever.
Yeah. That's why I'm like,
none of this makes sense.
I have to say as well, Edward Furlong was in a suit as well at one point, right? Because they're going to ask the Emmanuel Chikri to marry him, yeah?
Yeah.
His clothes look that did not fit.
No.
His clothes didn't look like they fit at all, right? Because his suit, like, you'd think at least, I want to say a decent sized suit, but. Not baggy, right?
No.
If you're in a movie, yeah? And if you're going to say the guy's, you know, he ain't got money in the head, right? But even then, it just, you don't make it that much larger than him, right? And then when he wears his crow stuff as well, it's just like, what?
I couldn't find him. It just felt weird. Like, I just kept on picturing him as, like, young John Connor.
Well,
because I can't.
He never comes across as a enough of a threat to anyone.
Yeah.
That you like. All right. This guy is, you know, this guy is the knight. This guy is vengeance. You know. No, he's just like, yeah. I don't know. Some guy over there. You know. For some reason as well. Eric Mabius. You know the guy from in number three, who's the nemesis, by the way, in Resident Evil.
Yeah.
He stole a Hayachi pimp jacket. Yeah. A pimp, you know, furry thing. And I'm like, what? What's that about? Like, he was walking around in his, I don't want to say his boiler suit, but you know, his death sentence suit from the prison, right?
Yeah.
But he's just like, well, you're walking around in that baggy thing. You trying to be Michael Myers? Or exactly what is your you don't look like, what's it called? I don't want to say a superhero because that's not what, you know, the vibes. But you just look like someone dressed you up.
Yeah, literally.
You know?
Yeah.
Not even a cosplayer because it's so loose, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It just...
It just don't look cool enough as well. I think that's the other thing, you know? Overall, you would never watch these films again?
Maybe in about 5 years' time or something. But no, it just did nothing for me.
Okay. Well, let me point out, right, none of these did also anything for me, but I'll point out something special for you.
Yeah.
I am watching the TV series.
Okay.
I am watching the Crow Stairway to Heaven TV series from 19, I think it ran from 98 to 99.
Yeah.
Ain't great either. It's got Mark Dacascos in it, right, as the Eric Draven character, which I'm like, you don't need to... It doesn't need to be that character that, you know, all the time. It's just because that character worked, you're saying, you're going to re-rinse the character. But it's just like, no, the character worked because the actor behind him was doing the job as well.
Yeah. You know?
But this is like, okay, you know how they paint their makeup and stuff like that on the crows? Here, yeah. Right? This is alter, kind of alter ego personality thing. Because he didn't paint the paint, right? He gets in situations and then it's like, yeah, that the crow makeup will come out. And he's a bit more of a trickster joke. Sort of, you know, a bit more wisecracking. It's just like, I don't know. About not saying that Marta Kessler's a bad job, because it's all right.
Yeah.
But it's daytime. All the time. No, you know.
Yeah. Because I've watched a bit of the series. I actually didn't mind it back in the day.
Yeah. It's not bad, but it's just, it's neutered. That's 100% what it is, right?
Yeah.
It's like PG-13, so he can't do the stuff he does, right? And then it retells the first movie in like one episode.
Oh, yeah.
The first episode. Yeah. And it's like, all right, but you don't see none of the, honestly, it's not about blood, gore, or like violence and stuff like that, but it's just, you don't see none of that in this. This is nothing about like that whatsoever. Yes, there's little martial arts action sequences and stuff, right? But, you know, I mean, because it's only one season, I'm watching it.
Oh, yeah, only got one season. I forgot about that.
Uh-huh. I want to say there's some interesting elements in here, but there's what they've got is the opposition crows, which are the snakes, which I haven't got to the episode of yet. But there also is a female crow in here somewhere as well.
Okay.
There's also the character of the Skull Cowboy. I don't know if you've heard of him.
No.
Okay, so in the comics, there was a Skull Cowboy who was basically the guide for the Draven character. Yeah. He had the skull, and he was dressed in cowboy clothes, right?
Okay, yeah.
It makes sense, yeah? Who was also in a movie, in the first movie, but in a cut scene where basically he was saying, so where Eric, after he was dealing with Fun Boy a bit, I believe, yeah, the guy with the razor blade, after he helped the lady with the cocaine.
Yeah.
After he got the cocaine out of her, he got slashed by the razor blades.
Yeah.
And because he couldn't heal he was interfering in stuff he shouldn't be interfering in, right?
Yeah.
Because he's come back to kill these people. That's what his mission was.
Yeah.
So that's why his costume changed. Got electrical tape around it afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah. But in the movie, it just happens and you're like, fair enough. I don't know why he changed his costume, but, you know, I accept it. Whatever.
Yeah.
It's cool. Fine. Whatever. Right. Yeah. But yeah, then the Skull Cowboy comes along and says, like, with rotten skull and everything, like, you know, in it. And because I think there's a deleted scene with him in it, but they didn't look great. But basically saying, you know, he, at the end where Sarah gets kidnapped, Skull Cowboy says, look, you can't, your mission is done. You've already killed all the people that have, you know, trying to scare to get you. Yeah?
Yeah.
You stay here. You do your stuff, right? You do anything to interfere with the living, yeah? You might not get back to the other side.
Yeah.
And because that's what seems to be happened to him. Just rotting there because, you know, he had to save someone or whatever. But they didn't allude to it. They just kind of give you the mystery.
Yeah.
In the series, there's this Skull Cowboy.
Yeah.
He's not dressed as a cowboy, nor is his head a skull.
Oh.
He's like, right? So, oh, yeah, by the way, I'm the Skull Cowboy. And it's like, all right, I don't get any vibes from you. That you are what you look like. Why'd you get that name? Where'd that come from? You know what I mean? It's like question marks. Yeah. By the way, I will have to say, when you're saying the third one seems like a TV series, like TV series pilot, yeah?
Yeah.
I would say the third one does hit the vibes of the actual TV series.
Yeah, okay.
And if they did a TV series of that.
Yeah.
Like 13 parts. Well, probably not that. They probably go to 22 episodes, you know, the standard length episode series.
Yeah.
I want to say I'll be unhappy or happy, but obviously the mystery, they would actually stretch out that mystery of, you know, who's the guy with the scars on his arms and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I could see elements going forward, right? Because that's what it looked like. Or they could have wrapped that up in the first couple of episodes and then progressed on the rest of the series. But there was something to it, right?
Yeah.
Kind of ish. You see Kirsten Dunst as the sister.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't know how bothered she is in this movie.
Yeah, same. I was like, because I forgot what year this came out. I was like, wait, why would she be in this?
Yeah.
I remembered, Spider-Man came out 2 years later. Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
But then this was probably filmed like 98 or whatever, 99. So, yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, she seems so much more infused than Spider-Man.
Yeah.
It's like, she's just like, here she's like,
I owe someone a favor.
No, she's like, I'll give some, I'll look. Certain times, I don't buy into this movie. It's a paycheck.
Yeah.
I'll do what I can.
Can.
Right.
Yeah. For when I'm minimum effort.
Yeah. Well, no, it's just like, I feel like she'll try at certain parts where it's like, all right, let me give you some, let me try something. Like my character going through certain things here, I shall do this. Right. But then other times you're like, I'm not bothered. I don't care about I don't understand what my character is doing. So I'm the, whatever,
Yeah. She's like, what's my motivation? Where was this? Sure, whatever. Yeah. And then just carries. Yeah. I'll get what you mean.
I have to say, the scummy cops as well, where the girl is, one girl's drunk in the car, one girl's driving her home, right?
Oh, and yeah, this... Like,
driver's license and registration, please. And the girl's like, let me tell you the truth, sir, kind officer. My friend's meant to drive us back, but unfortunately, you can see she's knocked out drunk and everything like that. I'm underage, but I want to get her home safely. I'm 15. He goes, get out of the car. Get out of the car. And then she's like, he's like, lean on the car. I'm like, oh my goodness.
Yeah,
oh my goodness.
Didn't enjoy this whatsoever.
Yeah. And then I'm like, so he tries to, he doesn't go as far as you think, right? Doesn't
really. Thank God.
No. But he kind of like, ooh, ogles her, right? And I'm like, okay, so they're trying to get me the vibes to hate this guy. But it's just like, I don't, this is not necessary.
No.
Because he's already a creep. Whatever, from the mannerisms, you could just tell, he was off key. He didn't need to go this level. Because then the girl's drunk. He's like, ooh, all right. Goes to the thing with Jake, the passenger side. And then he starts like running his hand on the thigh of the drunk girl.
Yeah.
And then he says to the 15-year-old, "Oh, you better, make a move or something like that, right?"
Yeah.
And then it's like, "What are you on, mate?" Right. And then what's funny is because he stands up so he can tell the girl to go away, right?
Yeah.
Comes back down, right? And there he is. The crow in the car somehow.
Yeah,
right? He swapped seats with the drunk girl. I don't know.
It may.
He does that multiple times. That version of the crow. Then that episode, he's like,
yeah, just
suddenly there, and then
and just there. And you're like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. Where'd you get these teleports?
Yeah.
I have to say as well. I'm not 100% on everyone's, the crows all having quote unquote martial arts abilities, right? Because Edward Furlong didn't fight like he got martial arts abilities. No. But I buy it for some reason. I buy it randomly because he's powered down from what he usually does in action movies. It's like bare basics martial arts and stuff like that. Even though he looks good and stuff like that. What I'm saying is in his other movies, he's so much more capable of other things. You're like, all right, I Eric Draven's fight abilities is, wishy-washy kind of.
Yeah. I don't know if I would even call it, martial arts. Even the Brandon Lee stuff, I wouldn't say it's, martial arts. It's like...
Yeah, but they're doing trapping and countering and parrying. And I'm like, where do you... But just then, brawl if you're...
I see, you could see it as this. It's not him, it's the crow?
I was going to say, you super fast reactions, whatever, right? Fair enough. But it's just a bit odd because all of these suddenly they never display any ability of anything whatsoever beforehand, and then suddenly able to do all these other things later on. I'm like, okay, yeah, I don't know. I don't know about. You're saying you wouldn't in about 5 years' time. What would intrigue you to watch these things again?
Boredom.
Because I have to say. Just to backtrack before you answer, I don't think I've seen all of them, all the sequels, and I don't think I've seen them for the past 10 years.
Cause I've seen the City of Angels before. And the rest I didn't even bother because I kind of made myself forget they existed.
Yeah, I think I've seen the past 15 years I've not seen them again.
Oh, that's a good thing.
yeah, that's the thing. The villains seem to get okay. So the third one is also weird, where the main cop somehow managed to gaslight the crow into thinking that he maybe actually did commit the crime. I'm like, wait, hold on a second. Yeah. Supernatural entity brought you back specifically, right? Because you need vengeance, yeah?
Yeah.
Quite obviously not kill the girl, yeah? But you're telling me Photoshop and this guy's, I don't want to say hypnotic tones or whatever, he just basically said to him, no, you killed the girl. You did it, all right? I know you had that argument that day. I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah, and he's like, oh, maybe I did. You're like, wait, what?
yeah. And then they're like, shoot him. And then he kind of falls over. And it's like, wait, hold on. So the power is psychosomatic? What's your logic? I don't...
Yeah. That makes no...
And then he realizes he did not kill the girl after all. He's like, oh my goodness.
You're like, dude, you know you didn't kill the girl. That's why you got brought back to life. You know, it's...
I did like... I did take note of the creepy girl as well. The policewoman cohort, whatever she was, right?
Yeah.
Because she had something to her. Not necessarily like alluring or anything like that, but just like, oh, she's different from all these other... Like, she's, you know... his underling, but also a bit obsessed with the, I don't know, goth culture, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then she tries to fight the crow. I'm like, all right. She gets thrown into their antlers, but okay.
Yeah, that was so weird. Because I turned around for a second and I saw that. I was like, oh, okay. Sure.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how much, you know, whatever, but it is what it is, right?
Yeah.
I think also maybe is the other thing is through the later film, the villain just got dealt with very straightforward ways. And not necessarily like, you know, they in the first one, they kind of went out in kind of more vicious ways.
Yeah, then the second one, they went out in weird over-the-top ways.
Yeah. Like, okay, so Iggy pops on his motorcycle, right?
Yeah.
And Ash shoots it. With a shotgun. It blows up the motorcycle, right? But Iggy Pop gets launched by the... Even though he's on the motorcycle where the flames are coming, right? He gets launched away from it by the force of what? I don't know. Shouldn't it be on fire? Yeah. It makes sense. Yeah. Thomas Jane's pink wig. I don't know what was going on there.
Nope. That made no sense.
No. I have to say as well, it's kind of funny how at the beginning of the movie in the second one where Sarah's like talking to some random girl. And I'm like, oh, she's like, oh, what do you want? Like, oh, you want to come to mine for some food or whatever, right? And you're like, hold on a second. Nowadays, it could be very creepy.
Yeah.
But that's what I'm saying is if you didn't realize from the first one, she was the kid in the first one, right?
I totally forgot.
Yep. And her life was like that. You're like, what? If it was a guy, and he went up to some little girl, my goodness, right?
Yeah.
Just because she's a woman, you don't think that way, except that it could have been that way as well.
Yeah, especially how this film is. So, you know, it's all weirdness.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I don't. Oh, and for some reason, right? It seems like in the second one, and partially in the third one as well. Oh, if you're how do we display these people as deviants, right?
Yeah.
Oh, they're into levers and BDSM and you know like the topless women dancing and stuff like that. All that culture. It's like I don't. I mean,
maybe, but this is like low hanging fruit way of doing.
Exactly. You're just shortcutting the film for making us like. To dislike these characters, but I don't necessarily like people practice whatever in their own time. That like whoever likes BDSM does not necessarily mean they're like a drug boss, kingpin, cocaine crackhead. You know?
Yeah.
I mean, like, okay, you know.
It's just it made.
Oh yeah.
Stupid. These films, yeah. They're like stupidly amazing.
Yeah.
But not in a good way. If that makes any sense.
Did you think, before, prior to watching the fourth one, did you actually think that, because you know how like, okay, the first one and the second one are similar as far as villains goes.
Yeah.
The third one is different set of villains, right? It's the corrupt cops or whatever. They're not like street thugs or whatever.
Yeah.
Did you think the fourth one was going to change it up, or did you think it was going to be what it was, revert back to the norm?
I never know what I thought the second one was going to be, if I'm honest. I was watching the fourth one. I was like, like the beginning completely threw me off. Like, I don't know what to expect going forward, and I didn't.
Nothing good, right?
No.
Nothing good.
Because it just went like bonkers.
Yeah. So the crow is somehow killing people in daytime, whatever, right? And then the cops tried to shoot him. Like at the end, him and Marcus Chung are having a little, their little fight or whatever you want to call it. And then they're like hiding behind the wall when all the cops are shooting at them.
Yeah.
And you're like, what's this? What is it? Okay. So, I mean, they're looking like they're going to stand off all the cops and kill. I don't know. I mean, I think here's the thing with the fourth one as well. The characters are so shallow. They do stereotypical things like Edward Furloung, you keep away from my sister, right?
Yeah.
And then even though I'm the cop and I'm going to bully you to town, out of the town. And then Danny Trejo, like, yeah, he, you know, I don't like him because my son doesn't like him because he's going out my daughter, whatever, right?
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, you, say stock. Say stock.
Yeah. It was like weird teen drama sort of background. Yeah, you're like, oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
And he includes Satanists and that. You're like, oh, okay, this is even worse. Yeah.
I will say it's actually kind of... So there's elements from here, from the first movie, right? If you think to yourself, okay, how did they make a series out of this from Stairway to Heaven, yeah?
Yeah.
And they actually point out, so you know how they throw him out the window, blah, 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 right?
Yeah.
He comes out of a portal in the sky for some reason, right? When he comes back to Earth, right?
Yeah.
In wherever they were, Los Angeles, wherever it is, right?
Yeah.
in a shopping mall, not in a shopping mall. You know, they're doing markets and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And no one's like, oh, where did this guy? If he came out, if he was, it appeared in not necessarily in the city, but somewhere open top.
Yeah.
You'd be like more logical, right? You'd be like. He could have just fell from the roof or whatever, right?
Yeah.
No, clearly came through a portal because there's no... How do you... Yeah. Anyways.
Yeah.
So, the same sequence where he threw him out the window, blah, 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 right? And then when he comes back, because that's where Shelley is in the series, that's where he came... That's where he sees visions of her. So he tried to keep the... that window area in the church, wherever they were living.
Yeah.
The flats, wherever, right?
Yeah.
And so when the landlord finally decides to come and clean up, right? A year later, by the way, after his resurrection.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, what are you doing here? You're supposed to be dead. And then Martha goes, oh, no. Oh, it was an undercover operation, you know? The police were involved here. And basically, you know, I went into witness protection. They pretend to throw me out the window and stuff like that because, you know, the people are... I had to end my mission, whatever. I'm like, all right, decent talk here. It explains sort of like why you would still be in the same place, and how the landlord's just like, whatever, just pay the rent. I don't care.
Yeah.
You know, like, okay,
you already said too much. I don't care. Sort of thing.
And then he has to go and kind of get a day job ish, but not. It's like, right, this stuff makes sense, but also doesn't make sense. Like, you're trying to cover up what you think are plot points, right?
Yeah.
But it's a supernatural, like revenge series, or you know, it could just be all action, whatever, right?
Yeah.
You don't need to have any of these. You don't need these minor bits. They don't kind of add or take away from anything.
Yeah.
What's the series? I want to say necessarily like Mutant X or something, but like, you know, just a series that's. Doesn't tie itself down with those sort of things, you know?
Yeah.
Just, like Supernatural, the people on the mission, that's it, you know?
Yeah, which makes sense.
Yeah. Are you going to watch the series afterwards?
I don't know.
Yeah.
I might, because I did enjoy it when I was younger.
Oh, did you watch all of the series when you were
most of it? Like, I can't remember it, but I know I did watch it.
All right. I knew going into this, by the way. I mean, I've heard of it for ages. This is the first time I've actually watched it proper. I knew going into it kind of what it is, right? So I accept it. But yeah. I would have thought, you know what? Tone has a lot to do with how that particular franchise is portrayed. And yeah. this series. Would you say you rank the series above some of the movies?
Yes. From memory, yes.
Yeah. Better than the second movie, or?
Yes. Because the second movie seemed like a... Hey, we had a good thing with the first one. Let's kind of copy that.
Yeah.
But make it more extreme. And
Yeah. I have to point out, by the way.
Yeah.
I did like how the lighting was. So, in the first one, it's all dark, right? It's all mainly blacks, dark blues with whites and for the lighting and stuff like that. But, you know, very, very Daredevil/Batman, yeah?
Yeah.
Second one was... They had yellow hazy lighting like Blade 2. And I was like, oh, you know what? That's kind of neat, actually, because you're making it different enough, you know. If you watch them back-to-back, it's a bit weird because the light, you know, the tone of the movie, the visual tone of the movie is completely different. Right?
Yeah, way different, yeah.
But then, you know, Guillermo del Toro pulled it off being that different from Steve Lawrence, and so, hey, you know.
Yeah, true. Yeah.
But, you know, you know what? If Guillermo del Toro did... A Crow movie or Zack Snyder even, right? I could get behind that because it's a very straightforward movie, you know, action wise and stuff like that. By the way, speaking of movies, did you hear about the reboots they were doing with Eric Draven?
Heard it been floating around for years, different versions and stuff. I'm just kind of giving up on.
So let me give you a couple of names.
Yeah,
that have been floating around. You tell me what you think of them. You know who Luke Evans is?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was going to be... He was floated around to be an Eric Draven at one point.
Okay.
You reckon he could have pulled... How do you think about that?
Well, he was Dracula Unleashed, so I don't know.
He was also Jason Statham's brother.
Yeah, Decker Shaw... No, wait. Owen Shaw.
Yeah.
He was all right as that, but I can't see him as... Actually, I don't know. Maybe.
Right. Tom Hiddleston, I believe one was.
Tom Hiddleston, really?
Yeah, at one point.
Nah, I wouldn't buy it.
Well, the thing is, like, you look at Loki.
Yeah.
The dark... I think he can pull off the look of the character.
Yeah, the look, but not the character.
Yeah, he'd have to be a different type of the character, because he's not as... I wouldn't say he's... After we've seen him visually as Loki so much, he's... not threatening physically.
Yeah.
Not to say he's not built or anything. He just doesn't give you them vibes.
No. I can buy him as a... In the Crow film, if he's a villain, I could buy that.
Yeah.
But I couldn't buy him as the antagonist. The protagonist. Yeah.
The protagonist.
Yeah.
this guy right here. Jason Momoa.
No.
That's exactly what I was going to say. I was going to say, only because, right, first of all, even if you're some jabronis off the street,
Yeah.
Why would you ever antagonize Jason Momoa? Yeah. Look at the size of him, you know?
It makes no sense.
You know, you'll die fighting him in the first place, yeah? And even if you don't die, you know that, like, the first thing, just like Jim Cornette said about Brock Lesnar, right? No one's going to mess with you.
Yeah.
Yeah, you muck about with someone, you do whatever, you terrorize someone, whatever, right? The first thing they're going to do is pull a shotgun out and try to kill you.
Yeah.
Because they know they can't fight you.
Yeah.
So you got to watch out, you know?
Yeah, it makes sense, yeah. I couldn't buy him as the Crow.
No, because you're like, Jason Momoa, if I tried to mug Jason Momoa, he'd probably, you know, snap me in half.
Yeah. It's silly.
Yeah, so unless they deliberately come to try and kill him, Yeah, but then you're setting the story off like, it's just like, okay, you know, I don't, I'm not even sure if he could match the look of it either, because I don't know how they would do it. He hasn't got the skin complexion, you know.
It's not even that. It's just nothing. I just don't get it.
I mean,
realistically, like, the crow could be any race. It's just like, it's got to be like a certain body build for me.
Oh, it's true, it's true. No, you're right. What I'm saying, but he does, okay, first of all, he does have that angry look about him. I don't know why, right? Maybe it's the eyebrows, yeah?
Yeah, it is.
but he's got that constantly, that scowl. So you're like, I don't know how friendly this guy is. He's probably really friendly in real life, but I don't muck about him if I saw the look of him there.
Yeah.
But when I say about his skin complexion, when they have to, if they put a white on him, he'd end up looking like Tama Tonga, right?
It depends what kind, like, as if they're in proper white with it. If they just do makeup white, like woman's sort of makeup white, then yeah, they can get away, but not like face paint.
Yeah. Although, to be fair, Tama Tonga does look frightening when he's wearing that face. But that, I think that's more of the expression they paint on his face, because it looks a bit weird with his beard painted as well.
Yeah, never made any sense. Yeah.
But yeah. So I wouldn't recommend people necessarily. Have you read the comics?
No.
Okay. None of the comics whatsoever?
Nah, none of them.
Because not even the first comic is like... His name was not Eric Draven in the comics, it was just Eric.
Okay, yeah.
And it's not quite the same. The thugs were thugs. None of them like a crime boss or anything like that. It didn't have that much action as well. He had the samurai sword in there.
Okay.
I think the movie made everything so much cooler as well.
Yeah.
Like, influenced by the comics, right? But it's just like... it seems to me that the film, like, Alex Price, the guy who directed it, put his own spin on certain things as well. It's like, you know when you watch the TV movie version of... When you read the book of The Ring.
Yeah.
And then you watch the TV movie version of The Ring.
Yeah.
And then you watch the actual Japanese... 998 movie of The Ring.
Yeah,
you can see what was added that made everything a bit more well put together.
Yeah.
That's the same here.
Okay, that makes sense.
Not that the book didn't have. It had elements here that you could progress further. You know, it's something like you just kind of added a bit more to it, and it's like, oh yeah, much much more. By the way, Yeah, did you see that there was a guy, Jeff Most, who has a part in all these Crow films?
No.
He's a producer of all the Crow films.
Okay.
Yeah. And I'm like, yeah, but I'm not sure exactly I mean, you know, like when some people get credits on their films, yeah?
Yeah.
You're like, oh yeah, maybe they did. Like, you know when Joel Silver does stuff and he goes, from the producer of whatever.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And then makes you think, okay. I don't know, by the way, when did being the producer of whatever make it so, has it become a credit?
I don't know. Like, it doesn't mean anything.
No. I mean, it can mean stuff. It's like when you have, like, oh, two of the four writers of a scary movie.
Yeah.
Or this whatever movie. It's like, right... But if you have a name to it, right, from producer Joel Silver, for example, right, when he does the stuff, you're like, all right, that's Joel Silver. I can kind of temper the quality of his films, right? Or from Avi Arad or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Or Kevin Feige, yeah? But when you say from whatever, the producer of whatever, without actually giving their name, that's when it starts getting a bit dodgy.
Yeah, it's a bit like, that's weird. Why don't you just say what it is? All right, but no. Cool.
So, hello?
Hello?
Hello, hello?
Hello? Hello? Are you there?
Hello,
quality's gone down again. Hello, hello, hello?
Oh, yep. Hi.
Oh, there you go. Yep. What was he saying? I forgot.
I said, when you have the producers in movies that have no actual name, that's when the movies start getting a bit dodgy.
And these are proof.
I will have to say as well, these movies, I think they all have relative, would you say a relative budget, because the Wicked Prayer looks really cheap.
Yeah, I'll say they'll have like relatively the same budget. Maybe the second one probably had a more higher one than the other two.
But this is just also weird when you look at it this way, right?
Yeah.
You look at these movies, like not these particular movies, but you look at movies in general, superhero movies or whatever, right?
Yeah.
And you're like, to make this film was $200 million or however much, yeah?
Yeah.
And then you look at a film like this, like, they made this for, well, the first one, for like $15 million or something like that. Not, you know, not over 20.
Yeah.
And you're like, well, I don't know. Yeah. It says $23 million here on what's it called?
The thing
is though, I think it started at 15, and then because of Brandon Lee's death and stuff like that, they had to put a further $8 million into it to complete it, you know, to pick up where they left off, to do all that stuff. But yeah, I'm like, but it looks, as a movie, it looks busy, you know, it looks like money's put into it and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And then you get to the second one, you're like, I don't know how much money is in this, but it doesn't seem like a lot.
Mm.
Not that it has to be a lot, by the way, the money put into stuff to make it. It's just like it has to look like a lot.
Yeah.
You can make use of your money on screen.
Yeah, rather than whatever they've been doing.
I think, like you were saying, by the way, the third one was like the third one was when they started going direct to video.
Yeah.
That kind of explains the way it looks, right?
Yeah.
But the fourth one, I don't get these movies, right?
Mm.
Take the crow out of these the sequels, yeah?
Yeah.
They take the name off the sequels, yeah? And there's nothing that would say tie into the first movie as far as franchise is concerned, you know?
Yeah. They would just like their own little weird things off of that, innit?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you seen Bones?
What, the Snoop Dogg film?
Yes, you know it. Yeah. You know exactly what I meant.
Yeah, I've seen it. Equally as terrible, right. Yeah.
Yeah, but it was like, that was Snoop Dogg's version of the crow.
Really?
Kind of, you know, where he got murdered and he came back.
I can see it,
I don't know, by the way, if necessarily he wanted to do a crow, but he couldn't get the franchise or whatever, and he's just like, well, I'll make my knockoff version, my hip-hop version of the crow, you know? Not necessarily that it was a hip-hop version of the crow or anything like that, but it's just like, yeah, Snoop, you make what you make, right? I guess, you know.
Yeah.
Can't knock it. But also, I would not also suspect that film is
worth your time. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can see.
But if someone did tell me, oh yeah, by the way, it's supposed to be Snoop Dogg's version of the crow, I wouldn't have thought it was that anyways.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, but, I definitely can see it.
Yeah. All right. That will close us off, because what is there to say about?
What can you say about this great film franchise?
You know, I was going to also say it comparatively. Would you say this is a good comparison? It is like the Batman Tim Burton franchise. Well, the Batman. I want to say the Tim Burton franchise, but you know, it's not. It's Schumacher as well, Joel Schumacher. Yeah. But that iteration of the Batman, even though the second one was actually really good, by the way. But by the time you get to the third and fourth one,
I might agree.
However, there's entertainment value in Batman and Robin, but there's similar entertainment value in Crow Wicked Parent, except it's not as good as, you know, you can't laugh at it that much. It's not on the same level. It's like, yeah, it's bad because somehow Dave Boreanaz can do fly, like he can jump up, right, and do jump across wherever he is to kick Edward Furloung. Like, don't step out of the church, do like flying Liu Kang bicycle kick him flying. It's just like, yeah, okay. I mean, it's wacky, right? Just like Batman and Robin is wacky, but it's just only one guy is doing the wackiness, and it just makes it a bit weird.
Yeah. Yeah. It's really out of place.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so I have been the police captain who does a Mexican fire dance? I don't exactly know. To resurrect the crow after he's been beaten up, so he can save my daughter. No, so he can save the soul of my daughter? CY Chan.
And I am the junkie who goes to tattoo parlors and punches men and women in the face because I'm Iggy Pop, Carl Charles. And I'd like to thank you all for listening to us talk about.
Here's the thing. I wouldn't straight up say we're criticizing it, but you just have to have it. Yeah, it's definitely a discussion.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the one. On the Crows movie franchise, it was fun. I'm not gonna lie, it was a fun discussion. I did enjoy that. I didn't enjoy watching them, but
yeah.
I did enjoy talking about them. And if you've seen any of the Crow films, let us know which one was your favorite. Or
aside from the first one,
obviously, because the first one's like a classic.
Well, it's one you can easily praise, so you got to go for the ones that you can't easily praise and why you like them.
Yeah, because it makes it more fun. And also, that's what I was going to say as well. The guy who played the Crow in the third one, what's that one called again? Salvation, yep.
Yep.
He was in Ugly Betty as the main character, one of the main characters.
Yeah.
I watched Ugly Betty and I was like, oh, that's that guy. Huh.
My sister's watched it as well, so I saw bits and pieces of it.
Yeah, I was like, oh wow, he went up in the world after this film. Good on him.
Well, yeah. I will. I mean, like, here's the thing, right? I mean, but same with Kirsten Dunst, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But she was young.
I will say maybe David Boreanaz went, he was already up. He went down and then he went back up.
Yeah. He just probably wanted money, if I'm honest.
same with Danny Trejo.
I've always seen he's a guy who could be in anything and he's fine.
Yeah.
He's fine.
Okay. But are we saying Edward Furloung, on the other hand, is just.
Oh, gosh.
downhill.
Yeah. Just downhill.
Well, no. I think he made a good turn, by the way, when he was in CSI New York. He was a serial killer.
Really?
Well, he was a serious killer. He was menacing Gary Sinise.
Okay.
He was like one of the big long character. I'm not saying that's a character arc, but he was a recurring villain.
Yeah.
But, you know, for him, so he did do stuff, but yeah.
Oh, I did not.
He started at Terminator 2, and he just couldn't go anywhere.
Yeah, that was the ceiling for him. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sadly. Yeah. sorry. Now back to if let us know what you thought of them, and you can do that by dropping us an email or a Instagram message or a tweet, and let us know what you thought of them. Also, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe your friends if you're watching this on YouTube. If you listen to this on the audio realm, give us a like and leave a review so we can get our names more out there. And anything else I can't think of. But anyway, I'd like to thank you guys once again for taking a trip with us around the multiverse. Bye.
Bye.
Big Bang. Primordial ooze. Divine hand of a benevolent creator, all possibilities. Although recent events have given me doubts about the benevolent creator. You lied at my trial, Thomas. I don't even know you, man. Capital case 99-C115. Alex Corvus.